Colliding Worlds is sponsored in part by Always Here, now streaming on Amazon Prime, starring Jodie Littman, Angela Romeo, and Steve Ciceron. Always Here. Some say the rules are made by the future, but in the LaFleur home, the past controls the future. Join them and the entire cast of Always Here. After all, a mother's love is forever. Now streaming on Amazon Prime.
Hey, and welcome, everybody. This is Angela Valenti Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds. And some of my favorite people do things that I absolutely admire, which is called put pen to paper and write, like real words and stories. And they use vowels and consonants and all kinds of things. And it's not an X time, you know. I want to introduce David B. Wolman, who he says he's an author. But let me tell you, this man does so much more. But he's written a book, and we're going to talk about this book right now. Death Be Still. David, welcome. Welcome to Colliding Worlds. It's been a long time. It's been, we figured, 10 years since the last time we did
this. Yeah, we need to meet at least every 10 years, Angela.
Right? I mean, come on. Just, I mean, but your output is more than one book every 10 years, though.
Yes. A few more than one every 10 years.
Oh my gosh. It's still an accomplishment. And before we start talking about that particular book, how did you fall into becoming an author? Did you wake up one morning and go, I want to write? Did you always write as a child? And did somebody push you to it or push you away or what?
Well, my father was in the entertainment business, and he represented as an attorney and a CPA, but really more of a business manager, authors like Norman Mailer and Herman Wouk. He was, by the way, Ed Sullivan's business manager for 20 years. Anyway, I grew up in this household where all of these people were coming and going, composers, Frank Lesser, Paul Simon. But I decided at an early age that I really thought that what they did seemed like a lot of fun, and they projected the sense of having fun. I remember when Mel Brooks came into my father's office singing for the first time, the movie wasn't out yet, Springtime for Hitler.
Oh my God.
And the entire office was on the floor in hysterics. So I started writing very early. I was writing poetry when I was like 7 years old. My grandmother was a big supporter. She kept little onion skin copies in her purse, and she would take them out to show her friends. And I still remember her phone number because we used to talk like every day on the phone. She read everything there was to read. And then, you know, it's the old story. I was the high school correspondent for the local paper, the Yonkers Herald Statesman and the Riverdale Press. And when I went to Wesleyan, I wrote for the newspaper there. And I studied with William Manchester, who wrote Death of a President and great historical biographer. And when I, as you mentioned, I mean, I went in a lot of different directions in the performing arts world, but I worked for a producer when I graduated from college. And then I worked for the Village Voice, writing off Broadway reviews.
The best.
Yeah, it was great.
I used to love going off Broadway. You never know, and you never know how long it was going to last. It could last days, you know. But
yeah, it was always a surprise. The venues were unusual, but I loved it. I wrote feature articles for The Voice, and then I was lucky enough to run into the managing editor of Playboy Press, and they were a mass market paperback for the most part company, nothing to do really with Playboy. I mean, they had a really great group of writers. As a matter of fact, Carolyn Horn, who was my first editor, just visited us here last week and we got to talk about old times. And then I got an agent, and he got me, well, you know, the whole agent thing. He got me several books. And then, you know, with my first wife, Annie Rachel, we started a performing arts group in upstate New York called Thornwood Center for the Performing Arts, which we did concerts, wrote a play every year. And then we developed the Central New York Renaissance Fair. And I wrote all of the incidental, you know, comic material for that. So, and then after that period in my life, I became a physician assistant in emergency medicine, and we moved to Philadelphia. So this was a whole other, I was still writing, but it was nice to have a steady
income
from something. Because books, you know, they pay you every 6 months if you're lucky. And after everybody takes their little piece, you know, there isn't very much left. But out of that experience, I wrote A St. Vitus's Dance, which is the book that I talked with you about 10 years ago. And so my new book, I've always enjoyed suspense and suspense thrillers and mysteries, and I grew up with Agatha Christie. Well, I didn't actually grow up with her. She's was a little bit older than me, but not much. But Dorothy Sayers and all of those people. So Death Be Still is a suspense thriller that revolves around a female doctor in Maine, a small clinic in Maine, and her name is Susan Schumann, and her life is a mess. I mean, she's just coming out of a horrible divorce. Her son, you know, is fighting with her. Her patients are complaining, and she arranges for a girl to get an abortion. Well, you can imagine in rural Maine, that didn't go over so big. And then the book deals with insurance fraud and identity theft. So this guy shows up in Maine who she falls in love with, only to have him disappear at the same time as a body is found in a nearby lake. And Susan, she has a cabin in the northern woods where she goes to try to chill from all of the stress of her job. And she has a dog sled team, and she's actually done pretty well in the Iditarod, the race that goes through Alaska. So the book moves from Philadelphia to northern Maine, and then to Virgin Gorda in the British Virgin Islands. So there's a lot of exciting switches of locale. And the other thing is I always put my characters always have a comic aspect. So there's, I think, you know, some good humor in it to break up the intensity of the but what one of the things that we did, I started researching the book, and my present wife Gail, who you met in California, I would have these books on my bedside about how to disappear, insurance fraud, what happens to bodies in water for a long time. And I didn't say anything deliberately, and at one point Gail finally said, "Is there something you want to tell me?" It's a little scary. And I said, "Yeah, I'm researching this book." So in order to research it, of course, Gail and I went up to Maine, and we went dog sledding and learned all about dog sledding. It was like 20 degrees and snowing and, you know, cold. But then we got to go to Virgin Gorda.
Yeah, it's not 20 degrees below there.
No, it was, that was nice. The book begins with a murder in Virgin Gorda. So we got all of that. I like to have the locations. In Philadelphia, it was Fishtown. I don't know if you're familiar with Philadelphia, but Fishtown was kind of the seedier side of town. So I would go to these bars and sit there and take notes, and these guys would be, you know, looking at me like, what is he, a cop? Or, I mean, what is he doing? So that was a lot of fun. But it's a real page turner. It's it's a good airport read, a vacation read, be great for this summer. It's available on Amazon and everywhere else. I mean, strangely enough, it's doing very well in Europe. They seem to like American books, it's a fun read. And I think anyone who likes suspense would enjoy it.
It was enjoyable. It was funny that, you know, because I could picture Maine. I grew up in New England. You know, I remember. Yeah. I had friends and they lived in towns in Maine where if you wrote Rosa, Jefferson, Maine, that's it. It would get to them. Yeah. I mean, it's that kind of, you can get lost there. Right. It's a funny sort of place. And then you got the old Yankees and, you know, the old joke was, you know, how long have you lived here? And the answer would always be, I ain't dead yet. And that's, you know, that's just the way they are. It was interesting to me too, that what was cool about the book to me was this was a woman who had a career, who had a lot of things right. And she wasn't a damsel in distress. She wasn't, you know, like, oh, I need, you know, it wasn't that kind of character. Because so often, you know, a lot of books, and you use airport book. When I think of airport books, and I wouldn't put this in there, I think of Harlequin romance novels where it's like, you know, it's like the bad seed overacting. It's like, oh, whoa, yeah. Why, you know, she wasn't a damsel in distress. I mean, she wasn't helpless. She wasn't stupid. She wasn't biting her finger waiting for some guy to come and save her. And that's kind of, to me, a good thing. The other thing was, and I appreciate this because when I write, I do my research. So I want to know that this character played flutophone when they were in the second grade, that this is where they, you know, it's those details, and there were in the book has the details to make it real. It's like the medical detail, the detail about the locations. I mean, you weren't living in fantasy; you were living in a reality that you could relate to, and that I thought was really cool. Because again, a lot of times some books are written in such a way that it's so stylized and so off the wall that it doesn't always ring true. Not like every book has to ring true, because God knows no Hallmark movie, no Harlequin romance novel is based in any reality that we all know. But it's nice to feel like your character was grounded, that someone could relate to these people. And the research, I think the research makes it better, because there's nothing worse when you read a book, you watch a movie, and you go, you can't get there from here. There's no way this could happen. There's this leap of faith that a logical person is never going to find, you know?
Yeah, and it's so much easier to write about something that you either know or you've experienced. So, you know, in writing all of the medical stuff that happens to Susan, I mean, that, you know, I know that stuff cold. And the fact that, Gail and I had never, you know, gone dog sledding before, but we went up there, we spent a lot of time with this gentleman that had the dogs. We learned about the dogs and the gear. And then I did a lot of research on survival, because as you know, I mean, one of the major scenes in the book without giving away the end.
Right.
Susan is a expert on surviving in the snow. So Gail and I think not something Gail enjoyed particularly, but we actually spent a night in a snow cave in northern Maine.
Oh, done that.
It was interesting, a little uncomfortable. But when you talk about how large Maine is, my daughter went to music camp in a place called Sweden, Maine, and we were meeting another couple whose daughter was going to go to camp there. Unfortunately, there are two Sweden, Maines. One was where the camp was, and there was another one all the way up on the border of Canada. And our friends unfortunately got directions to go up there. So we kept wondering where are they? And they were they drove 8 hours away from the camp. And there are still unchartered parts of Maine. And then, sublime to the ridiculous or ridiculous to the sublime. I mean, you go to the British Virgin Islands and it's just this, gorgeous people sitting by the ocean, sipping drinks and big sailboats. And I like that contrast, in the book. And the characters also are all based on people that I know really well. So I think that's the other aspect, besides doing really good research on a book, is if you can make your characters real. But and I don't necessarily just take a character and use just their characteristics. I'll merge maybe two or three people that I know where they each have interesting characteristics, and I merge them together and come out with a totally different character. So, I've done, the other thing is I've done all kinds of writing. I was an award-winning medical writer, published in medical journals. I published a book of poetry a couple of years ago. I actually have done historical romance. I did a book for Dell did very well. So I don't mind trying different genres, different styles, and at some point they kind of all amalgamate into what my style is.
I think the thing I always liked about being an artist is that you're constantly a student. And to me, that's the best job in the world. Mm. You can just keep learning. There's always something new. There's always something that captures your imagination. And it's like, my favorite, when I was in school and college, I had to write my paper, and I found this random footnote in a political theory book that said, of course, everyone knows the effects of the French Revolution on Mozart's magic flute. And I'm like, really? I must be nobody because I have no idea. Yeah. And I wrote my whole paper about the three chords and this and that. It just leads you down a rabbit hole that can be really interesting. And the research, what's cool, when you write, it's like to know the details. And I believe all the best fiction always has an element of truth. Every great movie has to have an element of truth. You have to be able to find the truth in the character. And when you base them on people that you know, and you use their characteristics, you use their mannerisms, you use all of those things make a character three-dimensional. They make the character relatable. It does change the tenor of a book. Now, this particular book, the technical aspects of it were great. The moving from scene to scene, that juxtaposition of Maine and the Virgin Islands is like, they're not the same. And there's beauty to be found in both of them. And it got captured. The whole scenes where, you were talking about the survival scenes, all it brought me back to my Outward Bound days. Do you remember Outward Bound?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
It would give you a match and send you out. They will get you in 4 days, you know? It was, but you learned, there was a skill that you learned, and it was interesting to watch skills be used, because especially, I keep looking at things now where I look at when I was a kid, that seems like ages ago. As I sit here at 65 and I think about the world as it is now, when I was a kid, you went out in the yard, you played, you went to scouts, you went to camp, you learned things, you learned how to, you know, I remember having a brownie troop and I having to take wilderness medicine. So if somebody fell and broke their leg, we could set it and what to do. It's now everybody runs to the internet and doesn't experience it or doesn't try it. They think they can learn anything from Dr. Google. And then it was funny to read the book, because like you said, there were parts of it I'm going, you have to have a practical knowledge to do some of these things. And the book didn't make me feel like I was reading about somebody that wasn't real. This person could do and think. And it was, that to me was what kept the book going and kept the book interesting. I didn't get caught up in thinking, well, that could never happen. I mean, you don't want to see a murder happen, but I mean, there was so many elements of it that you could go, yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, there's, you know, writing a book like this, Death Be Still, in one sense, you have to stay within the parameters in order to gain readers, as wide an audience as possible. But within that structure, I think the fun part is playing with it and, expanding the reader's experience with the book. And obviously, I really wanted to write about a strong female character. She's not somebody who, breaks a heel on her high heels when she's running away from somebody. I mean, she's extremely capable. She's under all kinds of threats as the book goes on. Then another aspect that was fun to work with was the fact that she falls in love with somebody who is really her opposite. I mean, he's in some ways very, very flawed, but has a really, really good heart. Takes in this guy who's dying, a homeless guy who's dying of cancer, and takes care of him until he dies. And you have these two unlikely characters, and yet there's an inevitability to them, coming together. The murder in the beginning, in the first few pages, it's kind of the sort of thing you have to do to get the reader to actually, pick up the book. But then you can do, I would say also the literary level of the book is probably a little bit higher than a lot of suspense thrillers. So, once you grab the reader, you can sort of lead them through some other higher aspects of reading and writing, and they don't object, because you've got all those other things. I mean, you've got the chase through the snow, and you've got the you have all of the elements that are intriguing and exciting, but within that, I tried to have good characters. I tried to have humor, and that's what makes it fun for me to write.
But it also makes it fun for somebody to be as a reader, because you're gonna when you pick up a book, it's got a beginning and an end. I know that in X number of pages, this story is going to be over. I know it. It's all self-contained. I look at the back of the book. I go, oh, okay, so. What have I got here? And it's like, okay, I've got a murder mystery. I know what I'm going to get into. Now the question is, do I stay with it? Some people, like me, once I start reading, I don't care how bad it is, I'll just read it because I can't stop reading it, because that would just drive me insane. But it was a book that once you started, you kept going because it was interesting. You're right. You hit all the elements. There was this love story. And as my ex-husband used to say, every woman wants a bad boy or someone that they can, you know, fix. There was a strong woman. There was a problem here. There was something exciting. The dog sledding and the Iditarod. That's something that holds for some people. There's a mystique to that, you know, because most people are not going to do it. It was all of these things that kept you going, but it was when you take all of those elements and you fit them together so that they tell a story, that's what keeps a reader going. And that's what was kind of cool about the book. It kept you going. You didn't want to stop. You wanted to keep going, but also too, you're right. It was written well. It was written so that I felt like I wasn't reading "See Dick Run," and there's nothing more insulting to a reader than to have the writer, the author, assume that their level of comprehension is such that, you know, it's a Twitter feed. And I like that. I look at a lot now, especially with the advent of AI. I mean, Amazon has a thing. You can only print so many, publish so many books a day. Why? Because they're AI driven. There's a total lack of something in those books that's not in a book like yours. Oh my God, you can only publish 5 books a day on Amazon. You shouldn't be publishing any books on Amazon if you didn't create it yourself. That's just my rant.
Yeah. Well, one of the big money makers on Amazon are empty books. It's just a book with a cover and blank pages. So it's gotten to the point of absurdity. The publishing world is really difficult now. I mean, it's all based on algorithms and, as you mentioned, AI coming in. And, I get all of these things every day about, somebody says, I can help you, get more hits on your website, and I can, do all of these, promotional things. And everybody's got a book. I mean, everybody in the entire world, has a book, because they keep reading about people who published on the Amazon or Ingram Spark or, and they're making millions of dollars, I want to be judged for what I've done, but it's become more and more difficult to get somebody to actually, read your book. And so-called traditional publishing is kind of fading away. The days of getting a book read at a so-called traditional publisher. I mean, you can't even get in the door, and they're busy, issuing the latest book by a politician or somebody who was adrift at sea for 400 days or as far as just writing good books. And so I felt caught in the middle, where I have to have certain elements for the book to be marketable. I can't show off my writing talent too much, because, that works against it. And yet, I have to kind of hide it. It's sort of, I've got to come up with a structure and a genre that appeals to a lot of people. And then within that, I have to sort of carefully, show my stuff without, it seeming to be too difficult for the average reader.
I remember when I started practicing law, and I did a lot of work in intellectual property. And so publishers, when I was a young lawyer, it was authors, you know, wannabe authors, and you couldn't get the book to the author, to the publisher, unless they were represented by somebody. The manuscript had to look a certain way. There's a whole book about what a manuscript should look like and all of that. And then over the course of time, it was like before a publisher would look at an author, the answer was, well, how many followers do you have? Okay. And then it became a question of social media taking over. Like, well, we're not going to look at you unless you have X number of Twitter followers. Then it just changed, and you're right. The traditional publishing is not the same. I mean, most people, when they buy a book, they download it. It's a Kindle. They don't buy a hardcover book. I miss the days of cracking open a book, looking at the end papers, smelling the book, and
absolutely
being able to read it. The other problem that I think I've seen, and is why I did appreciate the book. The attention span of a reader is become so small. They're used to getting sound bites. They're used to, Twitter feed. They're used to, instant message, whatever. It's hard to keep the attention span there. And then I look at schools. My kids went through public school. What are we teaching them to? It used to be when I was a kid, and then I go back to it. You had punctuation and you had spelling and you read and you expanded your vocabulary. And now it's almost laughable if you use a word that has more than three syllables, unless it's used in conjunction of a long swear word, in which case it's okay. But it just seems sad. This is why I like British novels and British, because they actually use like real big words and nobody flinches. And it seems that you as an author now have to be extremely cognizant of those kinds of changes. And
our language has, our language began with hieroglyphs, and it's gone through all these stages. And now you almost feel like people would prefer to have a book that was only emojis, just that's it. So we've gone from hieroglyphs full circle to hieroglyphs. But I think reading is, books are coming back, because I think people, there's something so special about sitting down with a book or being at the beach or wherever you are. And as you say, the tactile aspect of a book, and the history of books and paper and printing and at my age, by definition I'm a little bit of an anachronism, but at the same token, I'm fighting to keep certain aspects of the past alive, because they're not taught, as you said, they're not taught in schools anymore. So, I try to write books. Saint Vitus's Dance was a little bit more of a difficult read than Death Be Still, but still was an attempt to bring decent writing to a subject that had sort of a hidden mystery. But I think Death Be Still, and people can, my website is davidbwolman.com, and there's a video trailer, and there's a lot of information more about the book, and they can order the book from there, and it's ubiquitous in terms of where people can get the book. So the big thing is getting the word around. And as we said before, with you look at your Amazon rating, and it's like there are 300,000 books ahead of you. It's like, What do you do? And how many of those books are you know? I went to the top 10 and started, you know, reading them, and I mean, I couldn't find a book that I wanted to finish.
Well, and this is the interesting thing, okay? Because I was talking to somebody and I was looking about books, and so you look at what's at the top and how to get to the top, and this whole like thing about, well, your book cover's got to be this, and you got to get that, and you got to move up in the ranking. There was a time where you would get the New York Times had a book review. And you would get the book review and it would hold it in your hands and you would read it. There was a time when in books, the author went on a book tour and you actually had a chance to meet the author, to hold the book, have them sign the book or whatever it was. They did book readings. You don't see that happen very, very often. It's rare. My nephew wrote a book and he was able to get a book signing at Barnes & Noble. God knows he did fairly well because my sister is a master at rallying the troops. But those kinds of things make it aren't that common anymore. I see a lot of publishers don't put out the money anymore to support a book tour. They do the book, they put it out, and you, as the author, are left carrying the weight of promotion.
That's true. I mean, the first novel I wrote, Little Boy Lost for Playboy Press, they sold the book entirely on the cover. They took the cover to all of these book meetings around the country, you know, where buyers came. And, you know, it was a bestseller, and the first printing was 300,000. And I did book signings, and I remember walking by B. Dalton's in New York, which was a big bookstore that no longer exists.
Like and Brentano.
There were pyramids of my book in the window. And that world is, you know, that world is no longer the way things get done. So it seems like you have to know all of these little sly tricks of, you know, SEO and the algorithms and, you know, it's, I mean, I'm a writer. I'm not, you know, a promoter. So it's, you sort of have to learn how to do both because, you know, there's nobody out there to, you know, to really help you. But, you know, in the old days, if they did a printing of 1,000 of a new novel, that was a lot. And then word of mouth and, you know, but, you know, there wasn't as much competitive entertainment. Mm-hmm. People didn't sit around all day binging on the latest Netflix movie. People really enjoy it. As a matter of fact, I remember in my neighborhood where I grew up in New York, there was a book lending library, and it wasn't part of the library system. It was a profit-making. You went in there and you could rent a new hardcover book for, you know, I don't know, very little money. You know, and it was a tremendous interest in reading you know, I had conversations with Norman Mailer and Herman Wouk, and you know, the world of publishing from then to now is just day and night. You know, that's not going to stop me, you know, from writing because that's what I do. And it's just
the thing is, like, you have to keep doing what you like. What I find interesting is it's funny. You talk about that, you know, and I remember we had when I used to commute, it was a commuter. I was a Long Island, you know, railroad commuter for a while, and people would read books. And the person next to you would be reading a book, and I would strike up a conversation, and they would finish the book, and they would pass it on to you. And then now it's like, right, you know, everybody's on their phones, whatever. But the thing about that was having the book that pass around, that word of mouth, that conversation. The other thing I thought was cool about it, the guy next to you, you stoke up a conversation over a book, and you had nothing else in common with each other. And then you were riding this train and now you were sharing a book. It was a great way to actually dialogue with other human beings. It was wonderful. I miss that part of it. I think if you're a writer, you're always going to be a writer. And you are a writer. You've written plays, you've written poems, you've written novels. You're not going to change your essence just because the paradigm has changed. You just have to learn to adapt to it. And I think sometimes what's cool about the old days was the ability to meet the author. There's not those book signing days. I miss those. I miss that ability. I've actually remember going and meeting by chance the author because I happened to be at the bookstore, had no interest in whatever that person wrote, but then I got to speak to them. And I'm like, wow, it changed my perspective on what they had done.
Absolutely. Working with William Manchester in college, and also I had dinner with Elie Wiesel.
Me too.
Oh. Did you?
Oh my God. My short story. I was hiding in the corner. I was like 17, 18 years old, and I got invited to this salon, and he saw me sitting in the corner. And he said to me, "Why are you, come sit with me." And I'm like, whoa.
Yeah.
He was, I never left a meeting with an author so changed in my life. And then when it was done, I was just like, cause he was very calm, very sweet. Like, and then they were all going to dinner and he looked at me, he said, "Well, you're coming with us, aren't you?" And I'm like, yes. There was something about meeting that man and being around him and then reading his novels, reading those books, and it just changed your perspective. And I think that that's so important.
Yeah. I think ultimately it's going to be a more from the ground up kind of experience. I got a call from a lady the other day that her book club was reading my book, and I was so pleased. every little bit counts, and I think it's going to be more of a grassroots situation. I mean, so many book famous books have started out that way, as much as you need to take advantage of the latest methods of promoting your book, there's really so much fraud going on. There's so much people have realized that you can make a lot of money off of the hopes of artists of one kind or another. But I think a grassroots approach where word of mouth and where I try to do a lot on Facebook.
You do.
Posting and trying to get people interested in my take on things. I really think people would enjoy Death Be Still if they give it a chance.
Oh, they definitely would. And if you are on Facebook, and you can find David on Facebook, his posts are interesting. They're not like the usual, "I had tuna fish for lunch." They're kind of fun, I look forward to them. There's a few people whose posts like I love to follow because you never know quite what they're gonna do, and they're sometimes thought provoking, sometimes they're just silly, but sometimes it's just you feel a connection when somebody posts more. Now, when you're out there, you're trying very hard. You're an author. You're not a one and done. You've written plays. You've written music. You've written all kinds of things, but you're still like in an uphill battle. How do people help promote, or how do people help someone like you who's clearly, you know, not a fly by night, clearly not an AI generated bull. What do we do?
I think it's, you know, a lot of it is word of mouth. I've done quite a few programs in this area where I talk about the book. I did a program not too long ago about The Long Bright, which was a poem that became the text for a cantata and has been performed all over the country and has raised over $1 million for breast cancer research. I wrote this after my first wife died from breast cancer. And that was a wonderful experience because I got to interact with orchestras and conductors and in Los Angeles Symphony and, Philadelphia Orchestra, and just, you know, it was really a lot of fun. It was still about writing, but it was about writing something that fit into the needs of a composer. So I've always, you know, looked out of the box in terms of promotion, but my main activity is writing. So I have to get out of the habit of thinking that when I'm promoting, I'm not writing. So.
Well, it is a hard thing to do because you wear a lot of hats. And right at the onset of this interview, I said you were a person who had done so many things. You dig a little bit and you scratch the surface, and it's amazing what you have been able to accomplish. And I think it's just mind blowing. I mean, most people talk about writing a book. Most people talk about writing a poem. For crying out loud, people can't even write a thank you note. But you've done a lot, and you continue to do it. And you know, things happen, you move along, but you go back to your core as a writer. And the commitment to the art form is amazing, and the commitment to stay with it. You know, where a lot of people may have given up and said, I don't, you know, it's just too hard, it's not fun anymore. You stayed with it. And I think that if someone doesn't walk away from the interview with anything other than the fact that, you know what, you can do it if you believe. I was talking to my partner, John. I was talking to him about your bio. And I said, okay, other than doing nothing, this man has done nothing in his life. It's like every paragraph was like an accomplishment that most people would never reach. Or even if they got to one, they would never have gotten to two. I mean, I look at what you've accomplished and what you've done, and it's amazing to me. And it's so hard to condense it into saying, yeah, this is really just one person who can do all these things. If you go and you look, most of these books are still available. This is the book that's out there now, Death Be Still. I think it deserves not just a read, but I think it deserves a scratch into the surface as to who David is. And it's inspiring in and of itself. And I think that to me is just amazing that you did it. And I don't know, I get tongue tied sometimes with people.
Like, well, thank you. It's been a very interesting experience. When I became, I was living in a small town in upstate New York where we were producing the Renaissance Fair. And I joined the local EMT squad and got interested in medicine, and went back to school. You know, I did graduate work in chemistry and physics, and then got into the program at medical school in Philadelphia. But that really expanded. You know, that just gave me a whole other. I had put science to the side because I was always interested in literature. I was a English literature major, art history major, mm-hmm. and film major. And I had sort of put science to the side, but I think medical science has really opened up another part of my brain. So in both books, St. Vitus and this, you know, it has a medical background, and I feel qualified to write about it in a realistic way within the context of the suspense.
But you have to know what you're writing about, because it doesn't ring true when you don't. And that's what I liked about reading the book. I love doing research. I mean, I've got a show that I'm working on that involves incantations and Wiccans. It's been fascinating to read about them. I'm writing a horror movie about a serial killer, and you walk around with books about the criminology of, you know, whatever, and people look at you like you're crazy. You know, you might be, but you have to do the research, and it shows, and it makes for a better book. It makes for a better read. It makes for a better experience as a reader. I don't like to read something that, like I said, you know, if it's not fantasy and I'm not living on planet whatever, there's got to be a ring of truth to it. I also don't like the fact when I read a book and then it's like they got tired. So they just squash the end up real quick and they cover up everything. It's like, okay, I'm sorry you got tired. Either cut something out or make it a little bit longer. It's frustrating, and I have not felt that with either of the books. But I do have a question. When you start writing a mystery, do you start with the end and work back? Or does it, or you're like a painter, when you put the first word on the paper, does it just kind of take a life of its own?
Yeah, I generally... when I, some of the books I wrote for traditional publishers, it was necessary to have an outline of the whole book because they wanted to know what they were buying. But with this book, I had no idea where it was going. I had some ideas, but it's helpful to me to actually be surprised. You know, I'll be writing along, and then all of a sudden I'll get this out of the box idea for the next chapter, and I'm surprised. So I get sort of the reader's experience as I'm writing the book, and then, you know, you can always go back and change things a little bit. You know, sometimes I'll come up with an idea about three quarters of the way through and then realize I have to go back and rewrite portions of the whole first three quarters in order to make this great idea that I just had, you know, work. So that's how I do it. I don't plan it out. My first book, Little Boy Lost, I sold it on the basis, and you could do this in those days, on the basis of a first chapter and an outline of the rest, which doesn't mean that I stuck exactly to the outline, and I was working with an editor. Even with St. Vitus, I had a great editor who made a suggestion about the tone of the book. And I did go back and rewrite the entire book, changing the voice a little bit. It's told from the point of view of a psychotic janitor working in an emergency room who lives in this defunct section of the hospital that's been walled over since the 1918 flu epidemic. So I rewrote it in his voice. I think sometimes you know exactly where you're going and how you're going to get there, but sometimes it's an adventure. You sort of start and you don't know where it's going to end, and very often that's a good thing.
Yeah,
because it's sort of contagious to the reader.
Do you ever have a point where one of your characters gets like really bossy? It's like you're like, well, slow down. You know, is there? Do you?
I try to keep them under control. You know, there's a book, I don't even know if it's available anymore. This was many years ago. It was called Mulligan Stew. And the guy's writing this book and the characters revolt. The characters don't like what he's doing with them, and they start talking back to him. If you can find it, I've looked for it and I can't find it, but it was like 800 page book, but it was really clever. You know, when I'm writing, I'm in another world. You know, really nothing bothers me. It's just a place that I've always gone since childhood, to you know, be with myself and with my ideas. And then, of course, I like to hear what people think of it. You know, so when I post something crazy on Facebook, like the last one where I was talking about having climbed Mount Everest yesterday with a Sherpa named Morris Edelstein and a picture of me in a T-shirt at the Hillary Step, you know.
Oh, gosh. But it's a book can take you anywhere. I used to tell this to my kids when they were little. You can learn anything. You can go anywhere. You can be anybody in the pages of a book. There is nothing better. And it's funny how they can take over. I have a friend, I think he's still a friend, who wrote a book. And in the book, he had characters, and he based one character was on me and one was him. And we were a husband and wife in his book. And then he introduced his best friend into the book, and the wife has an affair with the best friend. Well, he wrote the book, and he got mad at both me and his friend for having an affair in his book. And we're like, you did this. We had nothing to do with it, you know? But a good story can take you anywhere, and a good book can take you anywhere, and a good anecdote. And to go back to the Facebook, it's like, they're interesting to read. They're quick little vignettes that are really, really fun to read. And I have a few people that I follow because I like their little stories and, you know, where they go, and they're interesting, and they draw you in. And that's the charm of what you have. I mean, you've done so much. It's, you've done more in this lifetime than most people would do in 10 lifetimes. And I am in awe of that. This is a book that even called it a beach book. I'd say it's an excellent read. I don't care where you are. I think it's important that we actually read a book. We actually pick up a book and we read it. I think it's important that we still support people who are creative, who take the time to write a book and don't run to ChatGPT and say, write me a book about a guy who died, and then go and publish it.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's time that we appreciate the skill and the training and the time and the effort that goes into being a true artist, to being a true author, and this is a book that shows all of those things. There's clearly a love of the craft. There's clearly the research that went into it. There's clearly a story with a beginning and a middle and an end, and it's thought out. It's not slammed together and you didn't publish five in one day. You published, you know, one. I admire anybody that can do it. And I'm not hoping that we'll be 10 years until the next time we talk, but I really would like to encourage people to check out David's work. Read this book. I mean, scratch the surface. The man is incredibly talented, and his wife is extremely sweet. And that's how I met David, was through Gail. I really, truly admire what you've been able to accomplish. And, you know, I really, I just don't even know where to start. I don't know where to end. It's like, this isn't the end. There's got to be another book in the works coming. There's got to be something you're working on next.
Oh, yeah, there'll be another book. And I really thank you for taking the time, giving me the opportunity to be on your program. And we need to stay in touch more than every 10 years, for sure.
It went by fast. When David said it had been 10 years, I was like, are you kidding me? And then I went back and I'm like, oh my God, yeah, it's been that long. And it's amazing what people can do. I love authors. I love anybody who can start and end a story. This is a true story. This is, I mean, not true in that it happened, but it's actually a real book. And I say, pick it up and read it. And trust me, I've got books here that are 600 pages. I got books here. My favorite book is still Wind in the Willows, an original.
Oh, that's a wonderful book.
First edition. And I've got Winnie the Pooh's daddy is inscribed it to his brother. So trust me, that book is incredibly special.
Gail and I actually, we do a lot of reading in bed. We actually read the entire works of Samuel Pepys. Gail reads and I listen, 20 volumes of Samuel Pepys. But she also read to me The Wind in the Willows, which I had read many times, but it's just a wonderful book. I mean, that's what books do for you, you know, it's just, and, you know, somebody like Samuel Pepys, he was never published. He just was keeping a journal, which fortunately survived. And
it's pretty amazing. But you know what? There's people out there who wrote one book that influenced many. You've got people who wrote one book, like Harper Lee wrote To Kill a Mockingbird. Yeah, I mean, she didn't really, her output wasn't that great after that. But it was a book, it was a story, it was something that captured you. And those may be once in a lifetime sorts of situations, but what you have here with you is you've got a lifetime full of great writing, and there's still so much more to come. Death Be Still, I did find it on Amazon. That's where I got it from. And it put the B in there, David B, because sometimes you might pop up and there'll be, you know, 20,000 other people with a similar name. So it's kind of important to try to add that, you know, that little middle initial in there. If you do read the book, reach out to David, let him know what you thought of it. If you have a book club that does it, let him know, you know, especially in these days of Zoom, you know, you never know what could happen, you know.
Absolutely.
Was there anything that we should have found out about you that I forgot because I got carried away with, like, going tongue-tied and awestruck?
No, I think we had a great conversation, and again, I really, you know, thank you for that. Just keep reading, and I'm going to keep writing, and you know, hopefully I'll have something to talk to you about
sooner rather than later.
Yeah.
I want to go try dog sledding. I mean, I've done snowshoeing. I've done sleeping in the snow cave routine, which I do not want to do again. Unless, of course, it's one of those big ice caves by the Aurora Borealis where they, you know, they bring you your drinks and ice cups. This is the thing that's cool about a book like this. It makes you want to try something new. You know, and I kind of like that.
I recommend dog sledding. Just bring a thermos of hot cocoa and a blanket, because it's pretty cold. Chilly out there.
And we were talking about book covers. Take a look at this book cover. It's deceptively haunting.
I like the cover. Like,
sometimes you only glimpse at the cover and it just either takes you in or it doesn't. Be a little adventurous and go a little bit further. But this is a beautiful cover. It's haunting. It tells a story without telling you where, you know, doesn't tell you everything. And that's great. David's book, Death Be Still. He has other books out there. The man has done more than I can think of. I'm tired just thinking about it. Thank you once again for being part of the show.
Thank you.
David, be like boy, Wolman. And when you look it up, please add the B because sometimes it gets confusing. Death Be Still is his book. And this has been Colliding Worlds. And I hope you had as much fun as I did. And I thank David.
It was a delight. I really enjoyed it. You're a delight to talk to.
We always have fun on the show. No one's died. Everybody's been good. We're good. I always tell some people are scared. You know, we're good. Till next time, this is Angela Valenti Romeo. This is David B. Wolman. This is his book, Death Be Still. Reach out. And if you read it, let us know on Facebook. Thank you so much for everything. Have a great day, everyone.